The title of my talk is a general blow-up result for degenerate hyperbolic inequality in an exterior domain. So let me just first, inequalities in an exterior domain. So the formulation of the problem is the following. And you will see in a few minutes that it has a history and it is not a trivial history. So we wanted to study the large time behavior of solutions of hyperbolic type inequalities. So most of the time, the nonlinearities of these hyperbolic equations are not of the form, the magnitude of u to the power p. It should be magnitude of u to the power p minus 2u or something else. But this one is just as a prototype of a nonlinearity, and we put the modulus of x to the power l just to put some flavor, a little bit more pepper and salt, but all these things are there, how to say, to render things a little bit interesting. And as you may observe here, I put x in omega, the complement of omega, and omega, we took it as the unit ball. So this is an exterior problem, and the exterior problems are very interesting for the hyperbolic equations. And our P has some restrictions. So it is greater than one. And then there is a relation between N and theta. It is here. I'm not going to read it. And also this L has to be greater than theta minus two. Well, and we are interested by three type of boundary conditions. And the first one is the Dirichlet type boundary condition, and the second one is the Neumann, and the third one is Robin type conditions. But it is sure that Dirichlet condition appeared in the papers of Dirichlet, and Neumann also appeared in the papers, in paper of Neumann, but Robin, it is creation of the Russians. They give it the name Robin, but he has never written such he's a French engineer, but he has never written in his papers such a boundary condition. I checked, but I didn't find it. Well, and the W, this function here on the boundary, it is L1 on the boundary. So this is based on our paper with Jlali and Samet, and it appeared in Bulletin of Mathematical Sciences, which in my opinion is a good journal. And our motivations, I told you, it comes from far. So Strauss, in 1981, he conjectured for this hyperbolic equation that the Fujita exponent for n greater or equal to two, I will tell you what it is, the Fujita exponent in a few minutes. That it is a solution of this Quadratus-Gleyssy. He was followed by Sidiris. Sidiris was interested in dimension one, two, and three, particularly. Schaefer solved completely the problem for n equal two. Georgiev, Lindblad, and Soge, they contributed. And finally, the problem has been solved by Yordanov and Tsang. They solved the problem in 2006. So you see, it took almost 25 years to solve such a problem, which is really astonishing, yeah? But you are going to say that there are a lot of problems waiting for solutions, not only this one. And Chu, he gave a very simple proof of proof of Yordanov and Tsang. And the paper of Yordanov and Tsang is one of the best papers that I have read on differential equations. It is a very interesting one. So more precisely, this is the what we call the Fujita critical exponent. So you see, it is horrible expression, and maybe in practice, you will never find something like this. But anyway, it is interesting mathematical problem. And so for any compactly supported the initial data with positive average, then the solution of the hyperbolic equation, this one, exists, blow up for a finite time whenever P is less or equal to this critical exponent. And when p is greater than this critical exponent, they are compactly supported initial data conditions, strictly positive, both of them, such that the solution to that existence exists, that problem exists globally in time. So this terminology, critical exponent of Fujita, it comes from the heat equation because he solved completely the problem a long time ago, in 66, if I do remember well. And and also it was attacked by Kato and at early stage by GB Killer. In this inequality has been also been studied, and they found another critical point, which is this time less than, say, the Fujita critical point, because it is n plus 1 divided by n minus 1, whenever n is greater or equal to 2. And when Pohoza visited Veron in France, they could relax the condition on the velocity. So they took the integral of ut strictly positive for any n greater or equal to 2, and for p less than p, this one c tilde, then they could show that there is no global weak solution to the solution 2, this one. And inversely, if p is greater strictly than this critical, in some sense, call it critical exponent, then they are positive global solutions to 2 and 3. Sorry, so someone is speaking. Anna, are you speaking? So a natural question is to understand the wave equation or inequality on another unbounded domains, and QS Tsang, in a very nice paper, this one published in Proceedings of the Royal Society of Edinburgh, he studied this equation. So you see, it is the same as we have I showed you before, for n greater or equal to 3, and also in the complementarity of a bounded domain with smooth boundary. And he showed that the critical exponent now is n plus l divided by n minus 2. So if you put l equal to 0, it is n divided by n minus 2. It is not n plus 2 divided by n minus 2. And when p is trapped between 1 and n plus l divided by n minus 2, this this problem has no global weak solution if W is greater or equal to zero, but not equal to zero, because he uses this one as for his proof. And when n is greater than this quantity, so this problem has global solution for some W strictly positive. So how can I get rid of this one? I don't know. Put it there. Yes. Okay. And the question, Tsang, he raised in his paper some questions, and he asked if that p n plus l divided by n minus 2 is a critical exponent. What about the case n equal 2, because he attacked the problem with n greater or equal to 3. And he also asked, what about the Dirichlet case? And in this talk, I will present you that the open questions raised by Tsang are answered by Jaleli, Samet, and myself. So we answer to these open questions of Tsang. Okay, so we need some definitions, and it is not for you. You are experts in differential equations, all of you. So just here to recall it for the students that they are attending this talk. So as you know, we take a test function and we multiply and we take the regularity of that is needed. So for this problem 5, so we define our say weak solution like this. It can be global or local depending on the time interval that you choose. Fine. So also for the others, we have also to choose different test functions. So for the Neumann one, we choose this. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time here. And also for the Robin, say, or the third boundary condition, we take another set of test functions. Okay, so we need these conditions, by the way, in our proofs. So we will discuss separately this case from this case. Okay, so the first result is that when n plus theta minus 2 is equal to 0 and L is greater than minus n, and if the average of the function on the boundary is strictly greater than 0, then for all p greater than 1, the three problems, they don't admit global weak solutions. Yeah. And however, if n plus theta minus 2 is greatly positive and L is also greatly greater than theta minus 2, and the average of the given function on the boundary is strictly positive, then there is a restriction on P. So P has to be less or equal to L plus N divided and N plus theta minus 2. Then for this, the three problems, they don't also admit global weak solution. And if P is greater than this quantity, this expression, then they admit all problems. They admit stationary solutions for some W positive. So stationary solutions, you can count them as global solutions if you want. Huh? Fine. So, okay. So the remark is that we can deduce from our result that if we specify theta equal to 0 and P equal L plus N divided by N minus 2, then in fact, in the case of the Neumann problem, we answer one of the questions raised by Zhang. So the problem doesn't admit a global weak solution. And if N is equal to 2, he also raised this question, and this integral of W, the mean is greater than 0, then problem, the Neumann problem admits no global weak solution for all P greater than 1. This also answers to an open question raised by Zhang. And you see from both theorems that Neumann and Dirichlet, they have the same critical exponent or critical behavior, if you want. And this also opened the question of Zhang, one of the questions raised by Zhang. So I think that it is not bad. And for the stationary inequalities, say, when we don't have dependence on time, so also we have the three problems, the Dirichlet, say, one, the Neumann condition, and the third type condition, then the theorem reduces to this critical exponent. So if n plus theta minus 2 is equal to 0, so PC is infinity. So if it is strictly positive, then we have restriction on P to have a solution or not. So this is in the same line as for those who knows this type of problems, of the same lines of, first of all, the papers of Michel Pierre and Pierre Barra that appeared in 1981, and they have been forgotten. And then Pohozaev, he revived them again, and also Zhang, they revived them again, but unfortunately they didn't know those papers because they were written in French and they have never cited them. And even in my correspondence with them, they didn't answer to my questions. But anyway, this is mathematics. And sometimes new things are old things written in a very how to say, surprising manner. So don't believe that everything is new. It can be very old, but rewritten in some surprising manner. So what makes things work for us that didn't work for Tsang? It is the choice of the test function. So with some choices of the test function, so with the very good choice of test functions, we can get our results. The technique is the same. And it is, as I told you, in the old papers of Pierre Barat and Michel Pierre, but maybe also, I'm not so sure, but maybe also some mathematicians in Russia, they approached this before Pohozaev, but I'm not sure, as I didn't read Russian, so cannot check. So Tsang used a test function with support away from the boundary, which makes it impossible to observe the effects of the boundary. So that's why. And in this work, we'll make use of harmonic function on omega c with zero boundary condition in that case, and homogeneous boundary Robin condition in the Robin case, which permits to cut off only at infinity, but not there is no need to do it close to the boundary. So what we condition that we impose on the cutoff functions are the following. So as usual, they have to be less or equal to one, but this is not drastic. It is equal to one in the boundary, and its support has to be strictly inside B0R. The gradient has to be controlled by this quantity, and the Laplacian of lambda r has to be controlled by this one. For x greater or equal to square root of r and less or equal to r. And no condition is imposed on the initial data. Okay, so what to do? How to do this? Let me first, and I will show you only how it works for the Dirichlet boundary condition, because then you will do the job for the others, because the techniques are the same. So what we do, first of all, let me define these quantities because I will use them later. So you see they are free from the solution. And phi is a test function. So you see they are free from the solution. And first of all, I want to get such an estimate, you see, on the term on the boundary, like this, in terms of these two integrals, two quantities, this one and this one. And you see this, I insist on this point, that here, this is, these terms here are independent of u. You have only the chosen test function and you can play with it. Okay, you can do something with the test function to control this term, yes, and obtain eventually a contradiction. So what we do, we assume that we have a global solution, and we will have some contradictions. So first of all, when we multiply by this test function phi and integrate by parts, integrate by part and through the derivative on the test function as usual. So we will get expression like this, and it is not difficult. We have to use just epsilon Young inequality with epsilon is equal 1/2 to split this term into two, and also this one into two. But what we want to do here for this first part is to try to get this term, but with a constant less than 1/2. Okay, 1/4, say, not 1/2, it is 1/4. And here also you may take 1/4 because, okay, or 1/2, it's okay. It also works like this. So we will get the extra terms that I told you before, so one depending on phi tt and the other one depending on the gradient on phi. They are here. So you see I11 and I1 phi and I2 of phi, these quantities. So they come just by application of Young inequality. And you have to select epsilon. And then when you plug everything, you substitute here, you estimate these two terms by these two, you put them here, and you see, then you will see that some terms disappear, and you will get this one. So, and now we have to choose the test function. We have to choose the test function, sorry. So first of all, we define this function like this. So for n plus theta minus 2, we define it as the log of the magnitude of x. If not, it is 1 minus this quantity. So this is f is defined. And it turns out that this f, and you have experts in elliptic equations. I have seen some names. They are experts in elliptic equations there. So it satisfies this problems, you say, this Laplace problem. Now we introduce our cutoff function. Okay, so as usual, it is like this. And what we have to do now is to select, you see, our test function as dx, and our dx is selected as the product of that function f of x times that truncating function, but evaluated in this quantity. And we take to the power k just to not have singular integrals at some points. And the theta t is the usual one, kt divided by t to the power k. So this is the choice that we have made that makes things work. It is this choice. And then we take our phi of tx, our test function, the product of both of them. And now for sufficiently large t, our function phi belongs to that space that we have defined for the weak formulation of the problem. Okay. And to study the critical case, so what we do is that we take lambda s is equal 1 for s less or equal to 0, and 0 if no, if s is greater or equal to 1, and consider this time this function here. So the test function will be theta t, the previous one, t divided by t to some power, and times this d bar x, which this time is defined like this. And also this one will belong to for the Dirichlet problem, it will belong, this function phi bar will belong to phi d. So this is the main thing. Now let's go for a brief proof of the cases. So when n plus theta minus 2 is equal to 0, we will obtain this. For that phi in this space, because you remember we could do it differently also. You remember we have here put 1/2 and 1/2, and then the term, this term coming from here plus the other term coming from here, then they will cancel with this one. Yes, they will cancel with this one. Well, and so we have this inequality, and we have L1 phi or I1 phi and I2 phi for this phi in that space. And now we have chosen one phi, that one, this one, and it's okay. Sorry, this gamma and d gamma are the same, and then it turns out that we can show that we have this estimate here. So, and then in that case, if we take our rho greater than satisfying this, and we pass to the limit, so you see, we will have something, we will obtain the integral of wxt, which will be less or equal to 0. And this will be a contradiction with what we have supposed from the beginning, that this mean has to be greater than 0. And this, you see it in the, in the paper of Véron, Pochozaev and Véron, because they imposed this condition also. And what happened when n plus theta minus 2 is strictly positive, I hope that it didn't make a problem with the sinus, then we have to do the same thing. We have to select just our row. You know the row from where it comes? It comes just from the test function. It is, you see, it is here. You have t to the power 2 row. So you have just to select that row. And then this is the scaling. Here I didn't tell you that you have to change also the variables and all those things. And then you will obtain something like this. And in that case, we finish by contradiction. Huh? We finish by contradiction like that. And the critical case, so we will choose this time that phi bar with d bar. And we will obtain also something like this. And this time we have to take t. It is r to the power g. And the g is greater than this quantity. So we are free to do that. And also we will obtain a contradiction. So in any case, what we assume at the beginning that the solution is a global, that is not possible. And in that, we answer to this problems of Tsang. Okay. And for theorem two, so also it is technical a little bit. And we have to choose, you know, this function u delta epsilon. It is in this form, but r is far from zero, so it is greater than one. And this one, it satisfies functions of this form, sorry, they satisfy this inequality. So this is the, how to say, the elliptic situation. Huh? And fine, we obtain explicitly these solutions. And you see for some epsilon, then you may maybe use other techniques to do that, but this is what we have done. So, it looks like it is done, and this is not bad. So we have answered the. It is technically, once you understand this technique of Michel Pierre that Bohozaev called nonlinear capacity, it will be very easy at the end to obtain this type of results. However, you see here we face that problem of the choice of the test function. So you have to choose your test function accurately in order to obtain the results needed. So yes, this is what I want to say briefly without any proof, without entering in details, because the details are in the paper. And we want to ask questions. What happens if this average is equal to zero and W is not identically equal to zero? So what can you say? And what happened also in the evolution problem when W on the boundary depends on T? And what happened if our omega C is the exterior of union of bounded domains? So you see you have something, you have a domain with the holes and you take the exterior of that. So it looks like that you have to work on every boundary of every one of these wi and how to construct the test functions, that we don't know. Maybe I know that you have some experts in elliptic equations. And just to understand what happened if we have two holes, then it will be very interesting. If w is w1 union w2, and omega c is the exterior, say, of two balls that they are far away the one from the other, it will be very interesting to see, at least using this technique, how to improve, how to deal with this situation. So we don't know. We don't know. We tried. We didn't succeed. Maybe some other people that can do the job. We have no idea. So you see, I told you that I lectured two times today, and I finished just before I come here to, you know, to for the talk, in this office for the talk. So I want to be brief because, you know, this is Ramadan, this is tiring. And I finished here. The references that we have used, of course, yes, you have Glacy Glacy, Sidiris, Schaefer, as I told you, Georgia Evelyn Bladsog, Yordanov Tseng, and Tzu. And these two papers of Kato and Keller, now they look like exercises. Of course, yes, the paper of Pohozaev and Véran, and the book, not a paper, it looks like a book of Mitidieri Pohozaev, 362 pages, full of ideas and results. And of course, yes, our starting paper, which is the one of Tseng, and this is our reference. So at the end, I would like to thank you very much for your attention. And